Okay, so let us start. Basic properties of triangles. Right. So in this basic properties of triangles, what we need to do is actually we shouldn't be knowing all the properties of the triangles. So we will be using the basic concept of the center, that is a triangle is having multiple centers. The centers are, one is the centroid and the second one is incenter and the third one is circumcenter and the fourth one is orthocenter. So we need to understand what it is. Okay, so the centroid is in a triangle. Let us say this is the triangle. Now this is A, this is B and this is C. Now if you draw the median for each and every side, so median is nothing but the midpoint. So let us say this is the midpoint of AB. You join the midpoint of AB to the opposite corner, that is this one. And similarly, the median of BC is joining from A to the midpoint of BC. And similarly, this also you can join. So this is, let us say this is E, this is F and this is G. Now here actually, so this is D, this is E and this is F and this point we call this as G. Now G is called as the centroid. Here actually one of the important property of this particular triangle is here the medians, if you draw to the opposite corner, all the medians are concurrent. Concurrent meaning, so all the medians will join at one single point. So if the lines are passing through a single point, we call that actually the concurrent lines. So all the medians are concurrent here. So this concurrence point is called as the centroid. Got it? Okay. And the next one is incenter. Incenter, this is the angular bisectors of a triangle. Are concurrent and the concurrence point is called as incenter. Here actually if you draw the triangle and this is A and this is B, this is C and this is angle A, this is angle B and this is angle C. Now the angular bisectors, if you draw a midpoint of this angle, let us say this is 30 degrees. If this is 30 degrees, you divide an angle which is equal to 15 degrees. So if you draw a line by taking the midpoint of this angle, which is nothing but the bisector of this angle, similarly the bisector of this angle and the bisector of this angle. Now all the angular bisectors are again concurrent and the concurrence point is called as the incenter. So this point is incenter. So this is incenter. If you notice, why we call this as incenter is, from this particular point, taking a radius which is exactly touching the any one of this side, so you will be able to draw a circle. Like this actually you can draw a circle. This circle is called as the incircle and this is incircle.
So the in circle
will touch all the three sides of the triangle, or all the sides of the triangles, sides of the triangle are always tangents to the inner circle. So this is the basic property of any triangle. So whatever may be the kind of triangle it is, whether it may be a scalene triangle or isosceles triangle or an equilateral triangle, so the angular bisectors always concurrent, and the concurrence point is called as the incenter, and with the incenter you will be able to draw a circle by touching all the three different sides inside. Got it? So this is the incenter. And the next one is circumcenter. So this circumcenter is nothing but the perpendicular bisectors of the triangle are always concurrent. And the concurrence point is called as circumcenter. Here actually perpendicular bisectors, so this is A and this is B and this is C. Now you can draw a perpendicular to this particular side, but it may not be passing through the other corner, so you have to identify the midpoint for all the three different sides. Identify the midpoint and then draw a perpendicular to that midpoint. So you can draw a perpendicular like this, and you can draw a perpendicular like this, and you can draw a perpendicular like this. So this is the point where all the three perpendicular bisectors will meet. So this point is called as circumcenter. So this is the circumcenter. Got it? So the importance of the circumcenter is you will be able to draw a circle by touching all the three corners by taking this as the center. So you can draw a circle so this is the circumcircle. So this circumcircle, as it is touching all the three different corners, from this point to this corner and this point to this corner and this point to this corner will be of same length, and this is called as the circumradius. Circumcircle radius. Got it? So this is circumradius, and this is the circumcircle, and this is the circumcenter. So this we have got by taking the perpendicular bisectors of all the three different sides. So this I think you might have already known. So at plus two standard actually you have derived the sine rule, cos rule and all. So sine rule and cos rule, actually there we will be using one capital R. That capital R is nothing but the circumradius. Got it? So this is one understanding. And the next one is orthocenter. the perpendiculars or the heights of all the three sides to the opposite corner of a triangle or concurrent. The heights or altitudes drawn from the side to the opposite corner are always concurrent. And the concurrence point is called as orthocenter. So here actually, if you draw any triangle like this, and then the perpendiculars drawn. So the perpendiculars drawn to the opposite corner. So here actually you need to draw a perpendicular to this line, but the perpendicular for this line, if it has to pass through the opposite corner. So let us say this is A and this is B and this is C. Now you can draw a perpendicular at any point on this particular line, but the perpendicular which is drawn to reach the opposite corner can be drawn only at this particular location. So this is what is the altitude 1. So this is H1. And similarly, for this particular line, if you draw the altitude which is passing through this one, so maybe at this particular point it can arrive. So this angle is 90 degrees. Again, if you draw the altitude that is passing through the opposite corner, so you can do it like this. So this one is again the altitude. If you notice, all the altitudes are concurrent. So all the altitudes are concurrent. So the concurrence point, this is what is called as the orthocenter. Got it? Orthocenter. So here actually, if you notice, this is 90 degrees angle. So this is 90 degrees angle, and then the sum of these angles, obviously it has to be 90 degrees. So this one, this small angle and this big angle together will make 90 degrees, and this is 90 degrees because in a triangle all the three angles sum should be equal to 180 degrees. Got it? So these are the basic understanding of different kinds of centers actually that we have to be aware as part of our statics class, because these are the centers that we are going to use down the line to find out unknown force components. Got it? Any questions on this? Any questions? Okay, fine. Then actually we can move on to the vectors. Okay. Vectors. So first actually we need to understand what is the basic definition of a vector and a scalar. So scalar a physical quantity whose description is complete only with its magnitude. Are called scalars. So here actually we are dealing with the physical quantities like the length, breadth or time, mass. So all these things are physical quantities, force, velocity, acceleration. All these physical quantities, when we wanted to have an understanding of those physical quantities, you have to be aware of certain values associated with that physical quantity to know the intensity of it. So, to know the intensity, you will be associating with certain number. That's what we call as magnitude, right? So, here actually, a physical quantity whose description is complete only with its magnitude. If I say that 100 grams, suppose if I say that the mass of this particular chalk piece or this pen is of 100 grams, then actually you will get a feel that this is associated with certain mass whose magnitude is 100 grams, because you are already aware of how much quantity it has to be if it is 100 grams, right? Suppose if I say that it is having a mass of 1 kg, then actually you will have an understanding how much it is going to be, right? But there are certain quantities, if I simply say only the magnitude, you will not get the complete understanding of it. For example, as I have explained yesterday, if I say that 10 newtons of force, then actually you feel that there is a deficiency of information there. So the deficiency is 10 newtons of force in which direction it is. So that is the deficiency that is there. So immediately I have to explain 10 newtons of force in the direction of east or in the direction of west. That is how actually I have to explain it. So there is a deficiency of information is there. That deficiency will make a lot of difference for us. Suppose if I say that 100 grams plus 200 grams is equal to 300 grams. So this actually everybody accepts that. So 100 grams plus 200 grams is equal to 300 grams. This everybody knows. But if I say that 10 newtons of force plus 20 newtons of force is not equal to 30 newtons of force. So this is the basic understanding of this vector. So we cannot say that 10 newtons plus 20 newtons may be 30 or may not be 30. Maybe sometimes actually even lesser than that. Sometimes more than each and every individual quantity, right? So here actually depending upon the direction of the physical quantity, so you cannot say that this is correct or not. But here actually we can be sure that this is correct. So why the difference is coming is the vector notation, vectors. So here actually a physical quantity whose description is complete only when we specify the direction along with its magnitude. Are called as vectors. So the example of vectors is force, velocity, acceleration. All these things are the vector quantities. Similarly, the examples of the scalars, mass, speed, density. So all these things are time, are the scalars. So here actually the basic difference between the vectors and scalars is, here the normal algebra whatever we have learned from our childhood, that is valid at scalars. But the same algebra whatever we have learned from elementary standard, that is of no use when we are dealing with this vectors. So the definition of this plus got changed in case of vectors. The definition of minus got changed in case of vectors. So, and the multiplication also, there is a multiplication of two different kinds of multiplication in case of vectors. But there is nothing like division in case of vectors.
Now actually we need to understand why there are definitions different for this plus and minus in case of vectors, and why there is no need of having the division, and why there is a need of having two different kind of multiplications in case of vectors, which are not there as part of the scalars. So there is a need to define, or there is a need to redefine the algebra whatever we have used in case of scalars in a different manner in case of vectors. So that different algebra that we have to be defining, that is called as the vector algebra. So the basic definitions of plus minus, everything will change. Now the understanding of this algebra comes from the basic notation, that is different symbols along with its operations. So vector algebra, so in this vector algebra the addition is different and subtraction is different, and multiplication is defined in two ways depending upon the application. And there is no application of division. In case of vectors, so division application is not there because we didn't find any use for the division. So that's why actually there is nothing like division in case of vectors. But the multiplication actually we might have, so actually the multiplication, we have two different kinds of multiplications that are defined in case of vectors. Why? Because the applications are different. Why the applications are different is, suppose if I take one body like this, and then on this body if I apply a force in this particular manner, so there is certain angle, with this angle I have applied a force of F. Now when I try to apply the force on this, this force actually is having a definite direction because this is a vector. As it is having a definite direction, now I am trying to push this particular body with certain angle. Now this force is having two different kind of vectors, that is one part is F cos theta and another part is F sin theta. So that is actually, I can put it here, so this is F sin theta, F cos theta and F sin theta. Why it is divided in two different components is, it is always advantageous to analyze in an easy manner if you divide into two different components of this vector, the same force but divided into two different directions which will have the same impact of it. That means suppose if I have a force like this, force is nothing but this is a vector and this is having certain magnitude and it is having certain direction. Now this force can be divided into two different components of this particular force which will have the same impact of the original force. So this is component 1 and this is component 2, whose resultant or whose effect is same as that of the original force F. So this is how we can divide into two different components, and we can separately analyze by making a standard direction of the horizontal direction and the vertical direction. So as you are familiar with the horizontal and vertical directions, it is always advantageous to divide into two different components which are perpendicular to each other and which are in the standard directions of the horizontal and the vertical. So that's exactly what we have done here. Now if you notice, F cos theta is the only force component that is essential in moving the body in this particular direction. So if you move in this particular direction, this is the only component that is responsible in making this movement. This force component is completely of no use. So you need to consider the component which is essential in moving. Let us say it moved a distance of d. Now here actually F cos theta is the responsible component which resulted in a displacement of d. Now the effective work done, so work actually will always have two different components. Suppose actually if I say that I have done some work, then actually in that particular statement of I have done some work, then actually there are two different things actually that are associated. whenever we felt that we have done some work, that means there is an essential component of movement of one particle from one location to another location. Suppose if I move from here to here, then actually I have spent some energy in moving my body from this location to this location. So there is a movement. Obviously, in this particular movement, I can move this pen and I can move my body also. So in moving this pen, actually I have spent less energy. In moving my body, I have spent more energy. That means how much force is needed in moving. So in both the cases, the force is different. So the force that is essential in moving and the distance, how much I have done. That is, suppose rather than moving from here to here versus I moved a distance of 1 kilometer. In both the cases, I might have used the same force, but the distance is different. Obviously, the energy I spent is more in moving the body from one location to another location, which is of a distance of 1 kilometer. So the distance component is essential. At the same time, how much force is needed in moving the body, that is also essential. So these two together, when we have an importance of two different quantities, then the resultant is always measured in terms of the product of those two. Here f cos theta is the responsible component in moving the body. Here d is the distance which is resulted by making an effect of f cos theta. So the product of these two is essential in spending the energy, which is nothing but the work for us. So w is equal to f cos theta into d. So this is what f into d into cos theta we call. So here actually there is a specific definition that was given here. That specific definition is f is a vector and there is a dot that got given, and d is two different vectors. So we have defined f dot d as f d cos theta. So this is just the notation in place of this cos theta component is responsible for the force. So this is what we call as, sometimes even called as, the scalar product. Scalar product of two vectors. Now, force is a vector component. Displacement is a vector component. The dot product of these two is a scalar. So work is a scalar. So this many joules of work actually I have done. So joules is the unit of work. So we are not associating any particular direction which is the resultant of this particular work, right? So I have applied a force which is a vector, and there is a displacement in a specific direction which is again a vector. The dot product of these two, which is equal to fd cos theta. We have given the definition for that fd cos theta as the dot product and is equivalent to the work in terms of joules. Now for joules, actually we are not associating any particular direction here. So as it is not associated with any particular direction, we can treat so this work as the scalar quantity. Now you tell me, when there are two different vectors which were multiplied with a dot, the result can be always a scalar quantity. So how can that be justified? Multiplication of two different vectors, can it result in a scalar? If it is yes, then why? Can somebody give me an answer? The result is coming out to be a scalar when we multiply two different vectors. Yes, that's exactly. So what Akash gave is the correct answer. So here actually there is no need of identifying the direction here. This f cos theta is always in the direction of the displacement itself. Now if it is always in the same direction of the displacement, why do I need to specify any direction? There is no need of specifying the direction, because you know that f cos theta is horizontal and the displacement is also horizontal. Whenever we do a dot product, the component of one is taken in the other direction. So the component of one is taken in the other direction, which essentially means that which both are having the same direction. So if it is the same direction, why there is a need to specify the direction extra again? There is no need of having the direction at all. Hence, the dot product will always result into a scalar. So this is how actually we have defined the dot product, and this is the need of here. F cos theta is the only responsible component in making this particular movement. Hence, F cos theta into d is always a scalar quantity. That is how actually we have defined the scalar multiplication. Now there might be a place where F sin theta may be the responsible component and which is doing certain thing, and that F sin theta we need to be considering there. So now let us see one more example where f sin theta is the responsible component. Now let us say, take this is the door, let us say this is the door. Now this is pivoted at this particular location, the door. Now door can be moved like this. So this is the hook, and that we can bring in like this and we can push in like this. Now here, when you try to apply the force on this particular door, now I can apply the force at this particular location. I can even apply the force at this particular location also. But here, when I apply the same force component here versus here, I might feel very, very tough to move the door if I try to push it from here, because this is the pivoted location and here the hook is there. From here actually I can easily push back, or actually I can easily push in. Now here actually the same force component is having a different kind of effect. Same magnitude, this is also 10 newtons and this is also 10 newtons. And here actually you feel very easy to move the door, but here actually we feel very tough to move the door. Now what are all the responsible components that are coming in picture here? See this, how far from the center actually you are applying the force, that is one responsible component. And another responsible component is, suppose if I try to push the door like this, then actually it is very tough to move the door. I am trying to push in this direction, but rather than that, if I try to push vertically inwards, then actually I feel very easy to push. Here the responsible component of the force is exactly the perpendicular component to this particular radius that is responsible in moving the door. So here actually the perpendicular component, suppose if I try to apply the force like this, out of this force component which is exactly perpendicular to this radius line is the responsible component. Hence this F sin theta is the responsible component in moving this particular door. And F cos theta is completely waste. So this is F cos theta, which is of no use in moving this particular door. F sin theta is the only responsible component. Only responsible component of the force in rotating the door. So here actually, if you notice, when you try to push the door, here the door is pivoted. If you notice, there is always a kind of rotation when there is an F sin theta component that is coming into picture. So the door can move inward and door can come outward, but in both the cases actually it is trying to rotate. So it may rotate in this direction or it may rotate in this direction, depending upon whether you push or whether you pull. So here actually two different directions of this particular vector result is coming out to be. So if it is one direction, that is, let us say this is the clockwise direction and this is the anti-clockwise direction. Here same radius, the same force, if it is pushed it is having one effect, if it is pulled it is having another effect. Now in both the case, push and pull, there is a clockwise and anti-clockwise rotation. So whenever there is F sin theta component which is responsible, there is always a result of the rotation. So always we will be having a rotation, and that rotation may be clockwise. Rotation is always treated in two different directions. So as everybody aware of the clock rotation, we classify every rotation either clockwise or anti-clockwise direction. So here actually clockwise, if you treat as plus, usually anti-clockwise is treated as plus and clockwise is treated as negative. That is the usual convention. So here actually there is a rotation of the clockwise and there is a rotation of the anti-clockwise. So here whenever F sin theta is there, there can be of two different signs that are coming out to be clockwise and anti-clockwise, two different opposite directions. Hence whenever there is F sin theta, then you need to associate the direction as well, because clockwise is different and anti-clockwise is a different direction. Hence whenever F sin theta is coming into picture, you always needs to associate a direction. So here the responsible component of the force is F sin theta, and where you apply the force, that is the radius, whether you apply here or whether you apply here or whether you apply here, whether you apply at the end, will have different impact of the rotation. Obviously you feel very easy if it is applied at the end of the door. It is very tough if you apply the same force at this particular location. Here two things coming into picture, one is the F sin theta, another is the radius. So the resultant is F sin theta into the radius. Radius is nothing but where you applied the force, whether you have applied here or here, it will make a difference. So this is what is the rotational component of the force. So this rotational component of the force is defined as the torque. So tau is always equal to F sin theta into R. This is loosely written as FR sin theta, and this is defined as R cross F. This is the usual convention, R cross F, R into F. Now here actually, obviously R cross F is a vector quantity. As I said earlier, the clockwise and anti-clockwise direction is associated there, clockwise direction and anti-clockwise direction. Now here actually, whenever we specify the direction, so here the clockwise, if it is treated as the upward direction, so whenever we define the torque direction, it is not in the direction of the R, it is not in the direction of the F. The direction which is the result of the cross product is always perpendicular to both the vectors, which is nothing but the axis of rotation. So this is the axis of rotation. So resultant is always treated as the axis of rotation. Suppose if you take the clockwise direction as the upward direction, which is the axis of rotation, anti-clockwise you treat as the downward direction, which is the anti-clockwise direction rotation. So clockwise is upward and anti-clockwise is downwards. So hence actually the cross product result is always a vector quantity, and R cross F is not equal to F cross R, because one product R cross F, if it results into clockwise, F cross will result into the anti-clockwise direction. Hence actually we use actually this direction. So mutually perpendicular directions. So if this is R and this is F, obviously this is the axis of rotation. Right? Suppose actually if you take this way, so if this is R and this is F, then actually this will be the axis of rotation. So obviously the resultant is the axis of the rotation. Hence actually there is a need to associate the product with a vector quantity. Hence this product is treated as the cross product. Cross product is nothing but a vector product. So vector product of vectors. So R cross F is not equal to F cross R, but this is equal to R cross F is always equal to minus of F cross R. Got it? So this is how we have got two different applications where F cross theta is responsible, where F sin theta is responsible. We have defined two different directions, hence actually we have got the understanding of dot product and cross product. Now this kind of applications are of no need in case if we wanted to divide, because there is no need of dividing the vectors. So hence actually we have not defined the division of the vectors, and the addition of the vectors is as usual. So you might have already aware. So addition of the vectors So coming to the addition of the vectors, we have two different kinds of rules. One is parallelogram law of vectors. And the second one is triangular law of vectors. So here actually parallelogram law of vector addition, what it says is, if there are two different vectors, the two different vectors is, one is this vector, let us say this is P, and another is this vector, let us say this is Q, then if you complete the parallelogram, so vector actually, vector notation, a line which represents its magnitude or whose length represents its magnitude and the arrow represents the direction. So this is very much needed to understand. Here actually the length of the vector will represent what is the intensity of that particular magnitude. So the length represents the magnitude and the tip of the arrow will represent the direction. So there are two different vectors, meaning suppose if I have a body like this, on this body I have a force. Actually, suppose actually I am pushing like this, and then actually I am pushing like this also. So there is one force component actually which is moving in this direction, there is one force component which is pushing in this direction. Now these two together will have a impact on this particular body, which is the resultant of these two forces together. Here actually this force is F2, or actually this one, this is Q and this is P. So this is Q and this is P. So the horizontal force and the cross force, so these two together actually will have an impact on this particular body. The resultant is nothing but the parallelogram. If you complete it, so you just complete the parallelogram by taking this length exactly equal to this one and this length exactly equal to this one, and the angles also you are putting as it is because it is a parallelogram. Now if you measure this length by a scale, and this will be the resultant magnitude. This is the resultant magnitude, and this angle is the direction. Direction with respect to P. So if you take the P vector in this direction, Q vector in this direction, this alpha is the angle of the resultant with respect to the P. Suppose if you take this as the reference, then actually beta is the direction with respect to Q, and this length will represent the magnitude. So this is how actually graphically we can make use of this parallelogram to identify this particular length and the direction, and you will get to know what is the resultant of these two vectors, or the resultant force of these two vectors, and the resultant direction of the vectors. Got it? So this is what is called as a parallelogram. Now here actually, so this is one force component, and another force component is joined at the tip of the other. Now the triangular law is nothing but the bottom portion of those two vectors. Suppose if this is the P vector, and triangular law, what it says is you try to join the other vector at the head of the first vector. So this is how actually you draw the vector. Then from the starting to the ending, if you draw a line, this will be the resultant. So this is what is the triangular law of vector addition, which essentially means that suppose if three vectors, if three vectors makes a triangle, makes a triangle, then the effective force will always be zero. Which essentially means that there is one vector, let us say this is P and this is Q, and then actually as per triangular law of vector addition, you need to join the tail of the next vector to the head of the first vector. So this is the first vector, and the tail of this Q is joined here, and then there is one more vector. If you join here, let us say it is making a closed triangle. So it started here, and this is one vector, this is another vector, and there is a arrow here, and the tail of the third vector is joined at this point, and the head is joining the first tail, then actually it is making a complete closed triangle. Now here actually we are saying that the sum of these two is coming out to be this vector. So the sum of these two is nothing but the vector like this, that means which is the same magnitude and opposite direction. So this is the sum of these two, which is of the same magnitude of the third vector but in the opposite direction. Hence the resultant of all the three vectors together will always be zero, provided if it makes a closed triangle. It may not be applicable for the only for the triangle, even for any polygon this is valid. That means suppose if you have a body like this, on this body let us say you have a force like this, and you have a force like this, and you have a force like this, and you have a force like this. Now four different forces are acting on this body, and all the forces are the coplanar forces. Coplanar forces meaning on the same plane on the same plane all the forces are acting on this, like the way actually I have drawn here on the board. Now all the three lines are on the plane, on the board of board plane, right? So like this, if it is there, then you can join all the four vectors, one tail to the other head. Suppose if I take this one, the first one, so this one is in this direction and the second one is in this direction and the third one in this direction and the fourth one, actually if I put it in this manner, now the resultant force on this particular body is again zero if it is coming and joining at the end. Suppose if it is not coming and joining, let us say this is of same, let us say in this direction, now there is a gap between these two. Now the resultant tail is always like the way what we have drawn. So the first vector tail to the other head. Now if you draw this vector, this will be the result. So this is what is called as the polygon law of vector addition. So this is the polygon law of vector addition, which is just a simple extension of the triangular law of vector addition. So if you join head to the tail of the other, now at the end if you are left with some gap, now you can fill up the gap from the first tail to the last head. That will be the resultant magnitude and its direction. So this is the resultant length, represents the resultant magnitude, and the direction is the resultant direction. So this is how actually you can add different vectors if there are multiple coplanar vectors that are there. Now here actually, see this, if there are two different vectors, if you wanted to add it, then actually let us say this is P and this is Q. Now the addition of these two vectors, which is nothing but, this is the addition of these two vectors, which is equal to R, and that R can be represented as P plus Q. So this is what is the vector addition representation. So this is the vector addition representation. Now I'll just analyze with the help of algebra. Suppose if I take the dot product of two different R's, so this is P plus Q dot P plus Q. So I am just applying the basic algebra principles here. Now R dot R is how much? Can somebody tell me what is R dot R? That will be R square, obviously. Why? Because see this, if there are two different vectors, one on top of the other, there are two vectors, same magnitude, same direction. Now here actually, let us say I call this as R vector. Now the dot product of these two, so R vector dot R vector, so as I said, dot product of two different vectors is nothing but individual magnitude multiplication and cos of angle between them. Now let us say the magnitude of R bar is R, and the magnitude of R bar is again R, the angle between them is 0. So cos 0 is 1. So R into R, which are simply the magnitude, no direction associated. Here actually, so this is R square. So because cos 0 is equal to 1. Similarly, R square is equal to P dot P plus P dot Q is equal to plus Q dot P plus Q dot Q. So here P dot P is P square and Q dot Q is Q square, and P dot Q is PQ cos theta, and Q dot P is again QP cos theta. So 2 times of PQ cos theta, and this is the addition of two different vectors. Got it? The same thing actually you can apply for the subtraction of the vectors. Subtraction of the vectors is nothing but, suppose if I have this vector P, if I have one vector P and this vector is Q, now I know that if I join the parallelogram like this and then join this, so this is R vector, which is equal to P plus Q. Now if I wanted to subtract the vectors, P minus Q can be treated as P vector added to minus Q vector. So this is what is P minus Q. That means I need to identify minus Q vector first. So this is minus Q vector, which is exactly opposite to the Q vector. This is minus Q. Now you apply the parallelogram law again, and this will be the P minus Q. So what you are doing is you are reusing the addition, even for doing the subtraction also, by reverting the vector of the first one, right? So you are reverting the vector Q to the opposite, that is minus Q. Minus Q vector, so minus is simply specifies only the opposite direction. Again, you can apply the plus symbol, or you can apply the addition procedure itself, so that you will be able to arrive at the subtraction. That is, this is the resultant P minus Q, and this is the resultant P plus Q. Got it? So this is about addition of the vectors and the subtraction of the vectors and multiplication of the vectors. And one more important concept that you need to understand is the unit vector. A unit vector is nothing but a vector whose magnitude is always 1 or always unity is called a unit vector. Now here actually the importance of the unit vector is, it is needed to specify a certain direction. Here actually the importance of this unit vector comes into picture. Till now actually without using any unit vector actually we were representing the vectors and we are adding, subtraction and multiplication. But the application of this vectors goes to an infinite level when you introduce the coordinate system to the vector. Now when we introduce the coordinate system to the vector, there is a need to specify the standard directions. That standard directions are I, j, k in case of Cartesian coordinate system, which essentially means that if I take a two-dimensional coordinate system like this, this is x-axis and this is y-axis. Now if you don't display this particular vector in the coordinate system, there is no need of specifying the unit vector. So here actually the unit vector application is coming only when you try to represent in terms of the coordinate system. For our mathematical analysis purpose, we can more standardize it. So that standardization requires a unit vector. Now actually, so every time actually when I am saying in the direction of x, so I have to associate certain magnitude in the direction of x, then actually always actually I shouldn't be saying in the direction of x and in the direction of y, or in the direction of negative x, in the direction of negative y. So there is no need of doing all these things. Rather than that, what we do is, if I just simply represent with single letter called I, then it is understood for everyone that actually this is in the positive direction. So this magnitude is of only 1, so the unit. And then actually if you multiply 1 with any other number, it will not make any difference to that magnitude. Suppose if I say that this point is at 5i, 5i meaning I multiplied these two, 5 into i. So I is nothing but a x direction, and 5 is the magnitude. 5y is nothing but on the x-axis it is having a magnitude of 5. So this is how actually I could able to represent 5 magnitude in the direction of x. Similarly, if I say that minus 5i is nothing but, everybody knows that magnitude of 5 from the origin in the negative direction of x, so that is minus 5i. Similarly, if I say 3j, so this is 3j. J is nothing but a unit vector in the direction of y. Similarly, if I say minus 3j, so this is in the direction of negative y. So by standardizing these directions into I comma j, now you can randomly identify any direction. All the infinite possible directions you will be able to identify with two different unit vectors. That is, suppose actually if I join this vector, let us say the coordinates of this vector is 3 comma 5. Sorry, the coordinates of this is 5 comma 3, let us say. If it is 5 comma 3, this can be represented as 5i plus 3j. So this is how actually I can represent. how I can represent 3i plus 5i plus 3j is, see here actually this vector is of 5i. So a horizontal vector of magnitude 5i and there is a vertical vector of magnitude 3j. Now as per triangular law of vector addition, adding at the head of the first vector, if we give the tail of the other vector, the resultant is always drawing the line from here to here. So this is the resultant vector, this is which is resulted by adding 5i vector to the 3j vector. So in general, as you are representing the coordinates of this point in our normal Cartesian coordinates as 5, 3, now this is as if like 5i plus 3j is a vector which is represented from the origin to that particular point. So this vector is nothing but 5i plus 3j. So I could be able to represent this vector. Similarly, if I identify one more vector like this, let us say this is 3i plus, minus 3i plus 3j. Now here actually, in the negative direction of x, this is of magnitude minus 3. In the positive direction of y, this is of magnitude plus 3. So here actually, the coordinates of this, if you notice, minus 3 comma plus 3. So this is the coordinates. You will be able to represent this vector by simply minus 3i plus 3j. Whatever may be the direction you can think of, you will be able to represent with two different unit vectors by representing in the x direction and the y direction. So a unit vector is nothing but a vector whose magnitude is always 1. Now you can randomly define your own unit vector also. For example, I wanted a vector in this particular direction but is of magnitude 1. So this is a unit vector in the direction of this one. For that actually we have a standard rule. For example, suppose the coordinates of this vector is, let us say, x comma y. If the coordinates of this is x comma y, you know that the length of this particular hypotenuse is always square root of x square plus y square. See this. The coordinates is x comma y. And you know that this is a right angle triangle. If this is a right angle triangle, the length of this is square root of x square plus y square. And then you wanted to identify a unit vector in this direction. You know that this vector, r vector, is represented as xi plus yj. And then if you want to identify a unit vector, let us say r cap. So cap is nothing but the standard way of representing the unit vector. R cap is equal to r vector. If you divide by its own magnitude, obviously this is always equal to the unit vector. So this is always equal to 1 in the direction of r. So this is the unit vector in the direction of r. Now here actually r cap, so this is xi plus yj divided by square root of x square plus y square. So this is x by square root of x square plus y square plus y by square root of x square plus y square j. Now this is a unit vector in the direction of r. Because if you try to identify the magnitude of this vector is always equal to 1. Let us see how it is. Now if you want to identify the magnitude of this is the square root of plus x square plus y square whole square plus y by x square plus y square under root whole square root. So this one x square by x square plus y square plus y square by x square plus y square whole power 1 by 2. If you notice, this is equal to 1 power 1 by 2, which is equal to 1. So you are identifying a unit vector which is of your own interest, which is in a standard direction. So this is the standard direction. Got it? So this is how actually you can identify a unit vector in any direction. But you have to understand, the fundamental understanding is that in a coordinate system, if you try to fit the any vector, then actually there is a need to define the unit vector. Now as it is related to the coordinate system, depending upon the type of coordinate system you are going to use, whether it may be a Cartesian coordinate system or it may be a polar coordinate system or it may be a spherical coordinate system or it may be a cylindrical coordinate system, depending upon the type of coordinate systems you are going to use, the unit vector definition you have to give as per the variables you are trying to think of. That is, in Cartesian coordinate system it is different, in polar coordinate system it is different, and in cylindrical is different and in spherical coordinate is different. So you have to have the fundamental understanding of these coordinate system along the vectors, so that will give you more insight into the topic. So not only statics and dynamics, even in fluid dynamics also that understanding is very, very important, so that actually you will be able to understand the concepts of fluid dynamics down the line. Got it? Any questions till this point? Anti-clockwise and clockwise direction. See this. Suppose here, take this hand. This is my hand. Let us say this is the pivot, and then this is the door. Now I tried applying the force in this manner. Now if I try to apply in this manner, now the door is moving in this direction. So if the door is moving in this direction, what is this direction called? This is a rotation. So this hand actually will try to rotate like this. As it is trying to rotate, this is how it is rotating, and this is a circular manner. So if I draw a circle around my hand, there is a circular direction I am going to get it. What is the direction of the circle? If I try to draw along the movement of the door, then what is the direction called? No, what is the direction called? Is it a clockwise or anti-clockwise? So that is anti-clockwise direction. Now rather than pushing my hand like this, if I try to pull like this, then actually what is the direction called? So obviously that will be the clockwise direction. So anti-clockwise direction and the clockwise direction. Now we are sure that actually there is a kind of rotational motion that is happening. As it is always rotating, you can define the direction of the clockwise and anti-clockwise. Every time actually you need to specify clockwise direction and anti-clockwise direction. But mathematically we cannot always write clockwise and anti-clockwise. For that actually we have to give one symbol, and that symbol actually we give that the axis of rotation is treated as the direction. So this is rotate. So this hand is trying to rotate about my vertical line, that is my hand. So if it is rotating in the anti-clockwise direction, if I draw a vector upwards, which is the axis of rotation drawn from bottom to top, and this is treated as the positive direction. And then actually if I draw the same line from top to bottom like this, so I treat it in the opposite direction, this is treated as, which is the clockwise direction, which is in the negative direction of the plus, that is the previous direction. Got it? So the downward axis of rotation is treated as the negative, and the upward direction is treated as the positive. Got it? Yeah.